responded to you. The next hadith, the proof or act of worship, which is an act of worship which is done by the limbs, which is al-dhabh, to sacrifice an animal. And he used the ayat, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Say, my salah, my sacrifice, my life and death is for the Lord of the worlds, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, and he used the proof from the sunnah, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ ذَبَحَ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. The hadith of Ali in Muslim, that whomever sacrificed for other than Allah, he is, may Allah curse him. Again, to do this act of worship, which to sacrifice an animal. Slaughtering an animal can be an act of worship, can be shirk, can be bid'ah, can be permissible. Okay? When is it an act of worship? When you do it to bring you closer to Allah. Okay? As an act of worship. This type of sacrifice to bring you closer to someone, if you do it to other than Allah, becomes shirk. Okay? When does it become bid'ah? If you do it in an act of worship, for instance, somebody wants to pray to ask Allah to bring the rain down, Salat al-Istisqa. While doing that, he goes and he sacrifices an animal for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say this action is bid'ah. It is a practice that people sometimes, when they go out to pray, seeking for the rain to come down, they may sacrifice an animal. We say this sacrifice is bid'ah. It's an innovation, it's not permissible. When does it become permissible? If you have a guest and you want to sacrifice an animal or slaughter an animal to feed him. This is permissible. In fact, you get reward for doing such a thing. Jazzar, what do you call that? La, not shepherd. Jazzar, Yasanusi. The one who sells meat. Butcher, okay. A butcher, when he slaughters to sell meat, is this shirk? No, he's not doing it as an act of worship. He's doing it to sell the meat. This is permissible, and so on. The next act of worship, another. Another is to make vow. And this vow should be only alone for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To say, I make vow that I will give 1,000 riyals as sadaqah. I make vow that tonight I will pray 2 rak'ah. This is an act of worship. I make vow to Allah. If somebody says, I make vow to the angels, to the jinn, to the righteous people, we say this is an act of worship directed to other than Allah. It becomes major shirk in this regard. So those are some of the acts of worship that the Shaykh mentioned here. Malish, I went very fast for the last acts of worship. But inshallah, all those topics will get into more details when we come to Kitab al-Tawheed. But this is to give you an overall view of the meaning of those acts of worship, inshallah. So let us stop here, inshallah ta'ala. And how much time do we have for salah? Like 4 minutes, maybe. If you have any questions, Yaho? Again, in this class, we just talked about the first principle, which is to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have mentioned that we know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through... to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we talked about 4 matters, knowing His existence, His rubiyah, His uluhiyah, His asma wa sifat, and we have proofs to support His existence, the exalted He is, and we have logical proofs, we have legitimate proofs, and we have the innate al-fitrah, and so on. And then the one who creates, and mentioned that the Shaykh mentioned a few signs, universal signs for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who has all those signs is the reason for the existence of those signs. He is the one to be worshipped. And he mentioned 14 types of acts of worship. And some of them are statements. Some of them are actions of the heart. Some of them are actions of the limbs. And we went through all 14 of them in a very, really, really quick manner. I hope everything is clear, inshallah ta'ala. And again, if there is anything not clear, you can ask now. Or... we can put the beginning of the next session to answer some of those questions if there is any vagueness in any way. Any questions, Yaikhwa? Khashya, good. We said al-khashya, the khawf is fear, okay? Mere fear. Khashya is fear while knowing what you fear. So it's fear and more than fear. It includes that you are aware and you know what you fear. In the case of khawf is general. Okay? Khashiyah is a specific form of fear, which includes that you know what you fear. That's why Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. Because they know who Allah is, that's why they have khashiyah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-khashiyah akhas min al-khawf. بالضبط. Khawf wa ziyada. More than the khawf. For the istighatha, can we ask or dua to Allah by our good deeds, like three men in the cave? This is not istighatha. This is tawassul. This is tawassul. We'll get to the issue of tawassul. Among the cases where you can have tawassul is you can have tawassul by Allah's names and attributes. And you can have tawassul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by your good deeds. Okay? And you can have tawassul by the dua of the righteous man. A righteous man calls Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, supplicates to Allah for you. So this is not istighatha. Those men in that cave, who each one of them asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by his good deed to open the cave and to move the rock out of the door of the cave. So it's called tawassul, not istighatha. Turn this off, yeah. So, and when something danger happen again to us, can we make dua again with our good deeds? The same good deed, or it's expired just one time? Again, this is tawassul. This is tawassul. Tawassul is fine, like I said, in your good deeds, it is fine. But to make tawassul by the Prophet, by other human beings, no. It's not permissible. You only make tawassul by Allah's names, attributes, your good deeds, and by the dua of the righteous one. It is fine to say, oh Allah, by my this good deed, please relieve me. Please cure me. Please give me this and remove away from me this. This is permissible to do so, inshallah.
But it's better don't use the good deeds in dua like
also. It's fine.
It's better to go to be away of it.
No, it's fine. Whether you do it or not, it's fine. You cannot say it's better or not better. It's fine. You can do it or not. It is fine to do so, inshallah. طيب بارك الله فيكم يا أخوة وجزاكم الله خيرا وصلى الله على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. More questions are coming. طيب let us do them real quick here. When we seek استعانة from a disbeliever, it is considered wrong. Some conditions. Why? Again, to ask استعانة help from anyone, any human being, whether he was a Muslim or non-Muslim, if he can do it, it is fine. If that help that you're asking from him, that human being, whether he was a Muslim or non-Muslim, only Allah can do, it is haram. Isti'ana, when does it become haram? If you ask someone to help you to do something haram. Okay? For instance, for when isti'ana is halal, I have a very heavy box. I said, Sanusi, can you please come help me carry this box? This is isti'ana, which is permissible. Okay? For instance, I have the same box, but I have alcohol inside it, okay, inside this box. And Sanusi knows that this box is full with alcohol. And I'm telling Sanusi, can you please help me carry this box? And he comes and helps me. This is haram. Whether that, huh?
Carry it to the garbage.
Garbage. Good way out, yani, mashallah. It depends on the intention, of course, yes. And in this case, if you're going to help someone to do something haram, then it's wrong. Someone's trying to climb into a house to steal, for instance. And I say, can you please give me a hand to help me jump into the house to go and steal? This type of help is haram, right? This is haram isti'ana. So it's fine to ask help from any human being, as long as that help is permissible. But if it is haram, asking for help in doing something haram, it is haram to ask from any human being, whether he was a Muslim or non-Muslim. The next question, what is the difference between isti'ana and istighatha? Yes, isti'ana is asking for help in general, okay? Istighatha is when you are in a state of danger. Isti'ana, meaning you're not necessarily you're in a state of danger. You're not in a state of danger, okay? Again, same example, help me carry this box. I'm not in a state of danger. Please help me. This is isti'ana. If I'm drowning, for instance, and I'm asking someone to help me. This is called istighatha. So istighatha is when you are in a state of danger. Someone is about to fall down and is asking for help. We say this is istighatha. Yes, could be like that. But istighatha in state of danger. Is it okay to say, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani ar-rajim? In this cases, when you enter market, when you yawn, when you envy someone. When you enter market, there is no hadith that says whenever you enter the market, you say Bismillah. Or you say A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani ar-rajim. But you may say Bismillah whenever you enter any place. There is a hadith that says whenever you enter a place, you say Bismillah. But to say A'udhu billah, no, there is no hadith for that. When you yawn, there is no hadith that says that whenever you yawn, you say A'udhu billah min ash-shaytani ar-rajim. There is no authentic hadith. But you can put your hand, your left hand, on your mouth when you yawn without saying A'udhu billah min ash-shaytani ar-rajim. When you envy someone, if you look at someone that has something good, of course, to envy someone, it is haram. You cannot envy someone. But if you see something good with someone, you say, Allahumma barik lahu. Oh Allah, bless what he has. Of course, the statement that says, say, MashaAllah, there is no authentic hadith that says, whenever you see something beautiful with someone, you say, MashaAllah, la quwwata illa billah. There is no hadith that states this. Although many scholars, they say this. Even old scholars, subhanAllah. But there is no hadith that for this issue. The hadith of when Sahal ibn Hunayf was struck by an evil eye. The Prophet told the one who envied him, he said, Halla barakt. Why don't you say, Allahumma barik lahu? So this is the statement which he taught to that person who envied Sahal ibn Hanif. So in this case, you may say, Allahumma barik lahu, but not, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. So in all cases, there is no proof for A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. In the last case, you may say, Allahumma barik lahu. In the first case, you may say, Bismillah. Or the dua of entering the masjid, Ashhadu la ilaha illa wahdahu la sharika lahu al-mulk wal-hamd, yuhyi wa yumit, biyadi al-khair wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. This hadith, some of the ulama, they hassanahu like Sheikh al-Albani, that it is fine that you say such a hadith whenever you enter a market, that you will be getting alf hasana, which is 1 million hasana. Some ulama, they say this is a weak hadith, but Sheikh al-Albani, he does tahsin for it, inshallah ta'ala. So let us stop here, inshallah ta'ala. One more question here, ma'ala shaykha. Sahaba used to tell, I sacrifice my mother and father for you, ya Rasulullah. Isn't kind of dhabh? No, of course, they do not.
They do not.
Yeah, fidaka abi wa ummi, mean that if I have not myself go kill them, but leave helping them to stand with you, ya Rasulullah, I will do that. Okay? Or may they die for your existence and stay. This is the meaning of the statement. But not himself going to sacrifice or slaughter his own parents, of course. This is not understood from such statement. Barakallahu fikum.